Well, those are the main stories in the South East. More election news from us in an hour's time. But for now, have a very good morning.
Have given us the chance to serve you. You have put your trust in us, and we say to you, we shall repay that trust for you. We govern for you.
Good morning. It is 8 o'clock on Friday, May the 2nd. It is a landslide for Labour, a landslide of historic proportions that has left the Conservative Party in disarray. Tony Blair becomes the youngest Prime Minister this century. It is predicted that Labour could end up with a majority of over 180. Conservatives have been wiped out in Scotland and Wales. Six of the Cabinet have lost their seat. It's a good night too for the Lib Dems, who are likely to have the highest number of MPs in their party since the war. And Martin Bell wins the battle for Tatton. The political map of Britain has been ripped to shreds. Labour have won a victory that has stunned their opponents and amazed their supporters. It's Labour's best ever result and the Conservatives' worst this century. Of the 628 seats declared so far, this is the state of the parties. Labour have 417, the Conservatives have 160, the Liberal Democrats have 40, the Nationalist parties in Scotland and Wales have 10, and the other parties so far have won. Let us look at what the forecast is of the result. Based on those 628 results, there you can see the winning post, and you can see Labour pretty comfortably past it. We are predicting they will have 419 seats in total. The Conservatives 166, the Liberal Democrats on 45, other parties on 19, and the Nationalists in Scotland and Wales will have 10. There have been prominent losers during the course of the night, and there are two of them: Michael Portillo, the Defence Secretary, and Malcolm Rifkind, the Foreign Secretary. There were others as well: Ian Lang, the Trade Secretary, and Michael Forsyth, the Scottish Secretary. And still more: William Walgrave, the Treasury Chief Secretary, and Tony Newton, the Leader of the House of Commons. John Major had this to say. Tonight, he said, we have been comprehensively defeated. We will listen to the voice of the electorate and reflect on it. And Tony Blair said this: tonight, the British people have given us the chance to serve, and serve we will with all of our might. Now, Labour's deputy leader, John Prescott, I think, can join us from our Westminster studio. Mr. Prescott, good morning. Can you hear me?
I'm having difficulties.
If I bellow, perhaps, can you hear me?
Well, if I stick my finger in my ear, perhaps that'll help.
All right, we'll both adopt undignified positions. What did you say to Mr. Blair when it became clear that this was a victory of a huge number of seats, and what did he say to you?
I think we were both surprised by the extent of it. I mean, we had battled basically to get a 6% swing in those 90-seat areas. To get this scale of endorsement is quite remarkable. And makes you feel a great deal of humility about it.
What are your plans for the day?
Well, we'll continue to respond and plan for government, won't we? Tony Blair will be Prime Minister very shortly, and he will then be planning his cabinet. I'll be having one of the first discussions with him, and we'll start to implement the programme that we fought the election on and build on the trust that the people have given us.
When you are implementing that programme and when you're planning for government, are you going to be involving the Liberal Democrats in your plans and your thoughts?
Well, of course, we have said that we want to cooperate on constitutional matters, of course, and even on the matters of the Commission about proportional representation. These are matters that Tony Blair made clear before that he wanted to continue with. I'm sure he will. That's the nature of the man. The result will make no difference to the promises and commitments that Tony Blair gives.
And your general attitude, though, will be towards the Liberal Democrats that they need not be wholly a party of opposition if they don't want to be, that they're welcome on board.
Well, we welcome any cooperation to help us with the Labour's programme. And I think whilst we've got an overwhelming majority, quite clearly, we still want to work with parties who want to implement the programme we fought on, and I'm sure that's what we'll do.
How quickly do you envisage taking difficult decisions that are going to disappoint people?
I think in government you always have political decisions, and they come rather quickly. Was that the last bit about disappoint?
Yes, I'm thinking how quickly that people who are necessarily going to be disappointed will feel that disappointment.
No, I think we've fought on that programme. That's a programme we intend to implement. You can't always tell everything will happen daily in government, but I'm sure we have that trust. We intend to build on it, and you can be assured we'll carry out our promises and our programme and hopefully not disappoint. But we're realistic. We know in government things can come fast and quick. It can come very fast indeed.
What would you say to a Labour MP who said, well done, John Prescott and Tony Blair, thanks for getting us in, and indeed you deserve praise for getting us in, but actually now that we're there, we will exercise a bit of our own discretion about those measures that we support and those measures that we proselytise for within the party. How disciplined is the parliamentary party going to be?
I think the parliamentary party showed itself to be very disciplined, and indeed we've all fought on the
that
same...
That was before this victory,
well,
though.
I mean,
it's a rather different scene, isn't it?
You wanted to scratch away at what you think is a particular problem, but we've shown great discipline as a party. We've shown great organisation. We've produced a wonderful result that has emphasised how the electorate like to see a unity in a party. But I would remind you that we have fought on a programme that was overwhelmingly endorsed. Over 95% of the Labour Party membership endorsed it, and that programme has now been endorsed yet again overwhelmingly by the electorate, and every Labour Member of Parliament will wish to see that programme implemented, because we don't intend just to win one election, we desire to win two.
Oh, well, Mr. Prescott disappeared suddenly there, but thank you very much, Mr. Prescott, if you can still hear me, for talking to us this morning. Now I think it's time to have a look at the whole story of the evening, and to do so in a slightly more reflective manner with the help of our political correspondent, Lance Price.
It was the kind of victory party that in 18 years of opposition, Labour feared they might never see again. A scale of victory that nobody from Tony Blair down believed would be theirs. But theirs it was. As the new Prime Minister-to-be acknowledged the cheers of his supporters, he paid tribute to Neil Kinnock, the man who started the fight back, and to John Smith, whose words he remembered. All we ask is the chance to serve. Tony Blair has been given that chance on a night that means the record book will have to be rewritten.
A new dawn has broken, has it not? And it is wonderful. We always said that if we had the courage to change, then we could do it, and we did it. And let me say this to you. The British people have put their trust in us. It is a moving and it is a humbling experience. And the size of our likely majority now imposes a special sort of responsibility upon us.
If John Major knew he was heading for defeat, he could never have allowed himself to believe it would be defeat on this scale. He'd watched as minister after minister, backbencher after backbencher, were swept away by Labour's tidal wave. The scenes at Conservative Central Office this morning could not have been more different from 5 years ago. John Major adopted a sporting metaphor. Sometimes, he said, the ball just rolls away from you.
Tonight we have suffered a very bad defeat. Let us not pretend to ourselves it was anything other than what it was. Unless we accept it for what it was and look at it, we will be less able to put it right. We've lost some very good servants of the party, people who've devoted a huge amount of their life to the service of this country and the service of this party. We've lost temporarily, I hope, some colleagues, both senior and not so senior, who still have a lot of service to give this country and this party, and who will, I hope, be back where they should be, in the House of Commons, serving us all.
The look on the faces of senior Tory figures marked the defeat of yet another cabinet minister. Labour took many famous scalps, but perhaps the one they celebrated most was that of Michael Portillo. He was planning to run for the party leadership. Now he had to face life out of Parliament altogether.
A truly terrible night for the Conservatives. I would have wished to have been part of rebuilding it inside the House of Commons. I can't now do that, but I would like to do whatever I can from the wings to help rebuild a great party which has a great future.
But a future without the Foreign Secretary, Malcolm Rifkind, the most senior member of the Cabinet to fall, both he and the Scottish Secretary, Michael Forsyth, were potential candidates for the leadership. Both fell by the wayside as the Conservatives lost every seat they held in Scotland. Wales, too, is now a Tory-free zone. The Conservatives hold no seats outside England. The massive swing to Labour was evident from the outset, but it was Birmingham Edgbaston, the first gain of the night, that confirmed that only the safest of Tory seats were remotely secure. Labour took seats all across the Midlands and the North, and for the first time in decades made serious inroads in the home counties. Stevenage fell with ease, although opening the champagne proved more of a problem. No problem for Labour, though, in parts of Sussex and Kent, as Tory majorities of over 10,000 tumbled. Famous faces were forced into reluctant smiles. David Mellor, former cabinet minister turned media star, fell in Putney, jeered out by the leader of the referendum party.
Is a derisory total. The referendum party is dead in the water. And Sir James, you can get off back to Mexico knowing your attempt to buy the British political system has failed. Thank you very much.
But while the referendum party fared ill, the Liberal Democrats scored triumph after triumph in their target seats. Paddy Ashdown now leads the strongest third-party force since the 1930s. While he lost some of his old parliamentary team, he gained many more, especially in the southwest, now Liberal Democrat country.
We are the largest force of Liberal Democrats and Liberals that this country has had since the days of Lloyd George. And we will use that force, we will use the vote that people have given us in the next Parliament with a hugely increased number of Liberal Democrat members of Parliament to fight every minute, every second, every hour through the next Parliament for those things that we have campaigned for in this election.
And up in Tatton, the constituency that attracted attention more than any other, the anti-corruption candidate, Martin Bell, easily defeated the former minister, Neil Hamilton.
I believe you have lit a beacon which will shed light in some dark corners and illuminate the Mother of Parliaments itself. It is a strong signal to the rest of the country which will be heeded.
A short time ago, John Major arrived at number 10 for the last time as Prime Minister. In just a few hours, the famous front door will open for Tony Blair. For the Conservatives, the recriminations have already begun. Some defeated candidates blame the campaign. The man responsible for it thought otherwise.
It's quite clear to most people, I think, that the events of tonight are not a reflection of the last 5 weeks. They're much more a reflection of the last 5 years.
But it was Tony Blair's night. As he flew down from his Sedgefield constituency to join that party in London, he knew that he was only the third Labour leader to win a Commons majority, the youngest Prime Minister since 1812. He'll start forming his cabinet later today, negotiating in Europe within weeks. But for now, he was savouring a victory of such breathtaking magnitude that the political world is quite literally at his feet. Lance Price, BBC News.
It is 13 minutes past eight. There are, of course, quite a few results still to come. And let me update you about one of them, which came just a few seconds ago. You may have seen it flashed up on the screen there. Truro and St Austell, the Liberal Democrat, Matthew Taylor, has held on to that seat. And I think we can see the style in which he has done it. There is the share of the vote, 48% to him, 26% to the Conservatives, 15 to Labour and 6 to the referendum party. And that's the change from 1992, the Conservatives down 12%. The state of the parties and what that does to the state of the parties, we shall, I guess, remind ourselves of. There we are. That's after 629 results, Labour on 417, and we are predicting a majority of around 180. 179 is the predicted majority at the moment. Now, Tony Blair has just arrived back at his Islington Home, Mike Donkin has been looking at the story of the Labour leaders' night, indeed Labour's night.
Before the curtain went up on the night of his life, just a hint of nerves. Then his once more famous father-in-law, Tony Booth, led the family outing to the Sedgefield Count. There, the children, Ewan, Nicholas and Catherine, who's nine, stayed up past their bedtime to watch Mum acknowledge one result that was never in doubt and Dad offer words of consolation to one Tory who had no reason for disappointment.
And if I can say this to Lizzie, who came second and who is the Conservative candidate, I once fought a very hopeless Conservative seat in Beaconsfield in the south of England, and look what happened to me.
By the time he reached his local Labour club, safe Tory seats were tumbling everywhere, and the Prime Minister in waiting allowed himself a little cautious confidence.
Well, you know me, I'm never complacent, but... No, it's looking very good all around the country.
Down in London, credit for this super soar-away result for Labour was a little unreasonably being claimed by the paper which once derided all the party stood for. But nothing could dampen the enthusiasm of those who'd waited 18 years to finally end an election night as winners. For the new tenants of Number 10, it was almost too good to be true. Mike Donkin, BBC News.
What then of the Conservatives' night? Robin Aitken has been looking at that.
They dominated government, they've been famous political faces for years, but their high profiles couldn't save them. Ian Lang in Galloway, and in Enfield, Michael Portillo, the Defence Secretary, and some said the Tories' heir apparent. In Harrogate, Norman Lamont and William Waldegrave all lost their seats as the Conservatives felt the voters' wrath. Colleagues looked on in wondering dismay as the political toll mounted. It was even worse than the gloomiest could have imagined. It was early in the evening when David Miller, another famous loser, faced up to the scale of what was happening.
A tidal wave has burst over the Conservative Party tonight, and it wasn't a question of putting your hand in the dike, it was a question of the seawall collapsing all around you. But I bear no grudges about that. I think that we're not a one-party state, and it is inevitable at some point that the government will change.
It was late in the evening when John Major appeared for the count at his Huntingdon seat. He won it at least, but inevitably now the question of the party leadership is unavoidable. The now ex-Chancellor says the party wants cool heads, not hot argument.
For us to fall to mutual recriminations at any time will be folly. For people within 2 hours of the polls closing to start going into mutual recriminations is extreme folly. And I do think the party needs to compose itself, lose with dignity.
And at Tory central office, a party which had almost forgotten what defeat means was learning that hard lesson again. Robin Aitken, BBC News.
There are broad smiles on the faces of Liberal Democrats this morning. To tell us why, here is Charles Rhodes.
Two o'clock in the morning and Liberal Democrats gathered at a London restaurant begin to celebrate a record-breaking performance.
As returning officer for the Torbay constituency, I hereby give notice.
In Torbay, the first of a flurry of gains took time coming. But after several recounts, the Lib Dems' Adrian Sanders defeated the Conservative candidate and spy writer Rupert Allison by just 12 votes.
It is 73 years since we lent this seat to the Conservative Party.
The breakthrough that Paddy Ashton had hoped for was sweeping the country. Victories in North Avon and Coleshorton and Wallington were among the least predicted. But in Rochdale, Liz Lynn and her supporters couldn't hide their feelings as they realised they were about to lose a seat Cyril Smith had first won in 1972. As the party looked forward to a House of Commons with the largest number of Liberal MPs since Lloyd George, some no doubt reflected that they'd done it without proportional representation. In previous parliaments, they could have expected to wield real power, but Labour's large majority suggests that Liberal Democrat influence may be limited. Charles Rhodes, BBC News.
Right, stay on the theme of the Liberal Democrats now. We can go to Downing Street, where one Liberal Democrat at least is. It is Lord McNally, who is, of course, a very close advisor to Paddy Ashdown, keen party strategist, who is very much one of the thinking people behind this campaign. Lord McNally, good morning to you.
Good morning.
The trouble for you is that, as John Prescott was telling us ever so diplomatically a few moments ago, actually Labour can say to you, well done, Liberal Democrats, you've done terribly well, but you are still a party of opposition. You have no more power than you had before this election.
I think that's true. We've no more power than we had before the election, except that although I may have ended up on the street, Justin, as you always forecast, we are now in Parliament with a bridgehead of MPs, that critical mass, that can make us a really effective opposition. I would submit more effective as an opposition than the Conservatives are likely to be over the next few months or years.
But you can't get done the things that you said in the campaign you wanted to get done.
Well, again, the things that we've campaigned on in the campaign, more resources to education, more resources to health, if the Labour government is not going to give those resources, then we're going to be in there fighting and arguing the case for the resources for education and health. We're also going to move on to the constitutional reform programme, which John Prescott acknowledged we'd already had an agreement with the Labour Party about.
All right, he does acknowledge that, but to what extent are you going to be successful in getting the future of the electoral system to the top of the agenda? Are we now suggesting that the Labour Party are going to have to look seriously at proportional representation?
The Labour Party, in a commission chaired by Robin Cook and Robert McClellan, agreed that we will have a commission appointed that will look at this matter and then make a recommendation that will go to a referendum. I believe the Labour Party will stand by that agreement and we will play our part in seeing it fulfilled.
Right. Lord McNally, you're in Downing Street now. You're not there because you're trying to break down that door. We've placed you there because you are, of course, as well as being an advisor to Paddy Ashdown, a former advisor to Jim Callaghan and a long-time insider in the Labour Party. You know the inside of Number 10 pretty well. What will be happening once Tony Blair arrives there? What goes on? Who says what to whom and what meetings are had?
The British system is the most brutal in the world. When Tony Blair walks through that door, the Downing Street staff, the very same staff who were serving John Major, will be there to applaud the new Prime Minister. He will be ushered to his study or the cabinet room, and his private secretary will put a folder in front of him for action this day. And then, as again John Prescott indicated, he'll be seeing his senior ministers. So it's business as usual, but with a new man at the helm.
Okay, Lord McNally at number 10 Downing Street, outside it, but nevertheless at it. Thank you very much indeed for talking to us this morning. Right, here in the studio we have Douglas Hurd, we have Neil Kinnock, and we have Sir David Steel. Good morning again to the three of you. Let me ask you this, Douglas Hurd. It's all very well, as people have been saying this morning, and you were telling us early on, that the party's got to see sense, got to calm down, got to unite around something. It couldn't do that in government. It couldn't do that with an election looming. How on earth does it do it with all the indiscipline that naturally comes along with being in opposition?
Well, because it's had a hiding, and hope that will enable it to recover some sense of sort of self-discipline.
It took Labour 18 years.
I know, and that is a real danger, that we would, as I said, wander off into the wilderness and start thinking, well, if only we'd been a bit wilder, a bit more negative, we'd have won. There is that danger. We have to resist that. But these are the kind of things that now have to be thought through.
The trouble is you have to be introspective, don't you? I mean, there's no other way. You must spend some time examining your own navels, and that is what Labour spent an awful lot of time doing, and it doesn't do you any good electorate.
No, we have to do that, but that depends what conclusion you come to. I mean, Labour under Michael Foot came to the wrong conclusion and wandered off, and it took a long time to bring them back. We have to come to the right conclusion so that we stay on the centre ground.
Neil Kinnock, how concerned are you about the discipline of this huge parliamentary Labour Party?
I'm not concerned about it at all. I think that, first of all, a great spirit of discipline, the best kind of discipline, self-discipline, has been built over these years, particularly in the last 5 years, and that will carry through into government. It won't dilute in any way the determination of members of parliament to represent their constituencies, but it will mean that where there are options for divergence over issues that obviously are going to come up week to week, the great instinct of the Labour Party in parliament will be to support the leadership. They have learned the lesson, and Douglas was referring to it, they've learned the lesson of the appalling pain that you have to take after you've been self-indulgent just for a couple of years, which was the case in the late 70s and the early 80s.
They know that they can be self-indulgent now. They have this huge majority. They're certainly not going to threaten the government. They will be able to act as free-thinking individuals. It'll be put in a positive light, but nonetheless, it will be in discipline. I wonder the extent to which you think Tony Blair would be wise to crack down in the same way in government as he has in opposition in his own party.
I don't think that he'll crack down in any oppressive way or any suppressive way. What he will do is perpetually remind the party, as he's got every right to do and maybe need to do, of what occurs if the party is self-indulgent and if it starts to put itself and its interests above the interests of the British people. And I'm simply saying to you, with some experience, that the Labour Party has learned that lesson profoundly, and it won't be repeating the errors of previous generations.
David Steele, will the Liberal Democrats manage now to change our electoral system?
I think it's almost inevitable. I mean, look at the situation in Scotland. It cannot be right, it cannot be fair that the Conservative Party gets no seats at all for the substantial vote that they still have in Scotland. There must be some heart-searching going on among Conservatives. And we have actually agreed in the Constitutional Convention that the Scottish Parliament will be elected by PR. We've also agreed with the Labour Party that the European elections should be by PR, as they are in every other country. And there's going to be a referendum on PR for Westminster. So I think the move is on.
Douglas Hurd, to a now much reduced party, and a party possibly thinking at least of splitting into pieces, I guess electoral form is suddenly an awful lot more attractive than it was.
Well, I used to think it was attractive, but it means the centre party, as in Germany, is almost permanently in power, and whatever you believe about democracy, that's not necessarily a good thing.
Oh, I don't know.
Well, the problem is, of course, that we've had these 18 years of Conservative government. The highest share of the poll that the Conservatives ever had in those years was 43%. That means 57% of the British people didn't vote for them, and they had 100% of the power. Now, in the last election, we were, in terms of the bottom 11 Conservative seats, 1,240 votes behind them. I would have been delighted to have led a minority government to make the change. But nevertheless, it would have been quite wrong to have a government that would have had about 36% of the poll. There's got to be deep reflection about the balance of our voting system, and I hope that the British public, with the referendum, will come to the right results.
And even now, with a huge Labour majority, there is nothing like half the votes of the country gone to Labour.
So, okay, gentlemen,
it has to be looked at.
We will come back to the three of you, Ivan, in a second or two time. I think we can go now to Tatton and to Martin Bell. Let's see if he's there and he can hear us. Mr. Bell, good morning. Martin Bell, can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you just fine.
Where are you going to sit when you get to the House of Commons?
It's a real problem because I need a crossbench and there isn't a crossbench. I had thought of alternate parking on one side or another, but I think I have to point out that there seem to be more Labour MPs as it is than can sit on one side. So it's still an open question for me.
And are you going to break cover, as it were, now and vote for individual issues? Are you, for instance, going to vote with the Labour Party when they put forward proposals on the health service? Are you going to vote with the Conservatives on other issues? How are you going to vote?
Well, honestly, I have no cover to break. I'm hiding nothing, I'm concealing nothing, I'm disguising nothing. I vote on the basis of my own feelings and conscience and the wishes and interests of my constituents, and I'm the only member of the House of Commons on either side who doesn't have to bother about a party line or a party whip. That seems to me to put me in an absolutely wonderful position.
Do you know, though, for instance, how you'll vote when the devolution bills come before Parliament? What are you going to say to those?
I'm taking these issues, these questions issue by issue. My feeling on devolution, again, I consult my constituents, but I don't believe there should be any constitutional changes without a referendum.
What is your view now of Neil Hamilton?
I didn't know quite what to feel about him last night. In a way, I felt sorry for him because he's been through so much and so has his wife. And yet, on the other hand, I reflected that he's brought this on himself and his party. All he had to do not to go through it was to stand down and not to be readopted. And all his party had to do was not to readopt him. Yet, amazingly, this thing went through. And as a result, also amazingly, I find myself a member of Parliament.
Yes, you say amazingly you find yourself a Member of Parliament. It is true, isn't it, that right at the onset when you agreed to do this, you didn't really think that you would have to go through with it all?
That is true, but after the famous ambush of Knutsford Heath, and after I'd felt the strength of feeling among the constituents, people of all parties, decent people, that felt that this should not happen here, I've become rather committed, and I'm in fact all fired up now to be, I hope, as good a constituency MP as they have ever had.
And you're going to do one term, and that's it?
That's right. I thought it was appropriate to limit myself to that as a signal that I have no personal ambitions politically beyond serving the people here.
Martin Bell and Tatton, thank you very much indeed for talking to us this morning. It is 8:30, and if you've just joined us this morning, let me give you an update of what has been going on, or indeed if you want an update because you need to spend some time thinking about the events of the evening. Tony Blair will be the next Prime Minister. Labour is celebrating its biggest victory ever. There's a landslide of historic proportions, with the latest results showing Labour have won a massive majority, a prediction of a majority of 179. For the Conservatives, on the other hand, and there is Mrs. Major and John Major going back into Downing Street. It was meltdown. Mr. Major will be tendering his resignation to the Queen later this morning. As you can see, had nothing much to say about whether he is going to remain as party leader. But he did say that his party had been comprehensively defeated. And just to repeat also the state of the parties, there they are. 629 results, 417 to Labour, 160 to the Conservatives, 41 to the Liberal Democrats so far, 10 to the Nationalists and 1 to the other parties. Now, the Health Secretary, or the former Health Secretary, Stephen Dorrell, I think, can join us now from central London. Mr. Dorrell, can you hear me? Good morning.
I can indeed. Good morning.
Why did you lose?
Well, clearly, before we reach a properly considered answer to that question, I think it's important for the Conservative Party to have a period of sober reflection to look at all the lessons that can be drawn from the election campaign. But among the pressures that led to the loss of this election, undoubtedly, were, in my view, first of all, the sense among the electorate that it was, in the words of the Labour slogan, time for a change. It would, after all, have been unprecedented for us to have been re-elected for a fifth consecutive term.
Isn't it the case, Mr. Dorrell, that the wait-and-see policy on the single European currency that lots of people warned would fall apart during the course of the election campaign did fall about during the course of the election campaign? In other words, it was perfectly predictable that the campaign would go awry as it did.
Well, I accept that one of the other issues that arose during the campaign, where we didn't succeed in establishing the true nature of the choice that the electorate faced, was the whole European question. And I think that actually, if you go and talk to people on the doorstep, it still remains my view that they do not want to see, the great majority of the British people do not want to see the kind of transfer of lawmaking power from Westminster to Brussels that Labour are committed at the very least to consider.
That's
an issue that will now have to be debated between government and opposition in the new parliament.
Let me put it to you that when you debate it within your own party, you will come to the conclusion that there is not a single unified purpose on Europe to which you can all sign up.
Well, I think actually, as the Prime Minister said many times during the election campaign, if you look at the issues that fall to be decided between this country and its partners in Europe this summer, the Conservative Party is actually totally united. We're against the social chapter, we're against transfer of extra competence under qualified majority voting to Brussels. That's one of the issues that will in fact become very clear, I suspect,
in the follow-up to the Amsterdam conference. Should you be a party that is fundamentally more hostile to Europe than you were when you went into this election campaign? In other words, a party that might at some stage before this campaign have said a firm no to a single currency. Is that the kind of party you're going to become?
I very much hope we don't become a party that is hostile to Europe, but I very much hope we do remain and develop ourselves as a party that has a clear view about the way forward for Europe to make itself more competitive in an increasingly competitive world, because unless Europe faces up to those issues, then more and more European people will be unemployed because it will become progressively more unsuccessful.
When should John Major resign?
I think that the position that the Conservative Party should adopt is to look at the underlying need for the party to rebuild its electoral position, to look at the issues and look at the positions and values it must adopt.
So,
and frankly,
those are
the primary questions. The question of leadership is a question that should be addressed after we have thought about some of the lessons that can be drawn from the election campaign.
So you are clearly this morning calling on John Major to stay in place for the reasonably long term. We're talking about a year.
I hope the Conservative Party will give itself time for sober reflection.
We are talking then further than the party conference.
I'm not going to be drawn on the question of timetable. I think it's important in the circumstances in which the Conservative Party finds itself that we address these issues in order. And the first thing we need to do is to look at the lessons to be drawn from the election campaign and to ensure that the party sets about rebuilding its electoral base as the authentic voice of the centre-right majority, which I believe still is the foundation stone of British politics.
Mr. Dorrell, thank you very much indeed for talking to us this morning. Let us go now to Wales and to Northern Ireland. Our correspondent, Tim Hirsch, is in Cardiff. No, he's not. He's in Brecon and Radnorshire. And we can see Denis Murray there at Belfast City Hall. Tim, pretty extraordinary night in your neck of the woods.
That's right. It looks like we're heading for a complete Tory wipeout in Wales, although the seat where I am now is just about to start its count, Brecon and Radnorshire. That is the final chance for the Tories to keep any of their Welsh seats, but since they only held it with a majority of just 130 last time, it seems extremely likely that they will hold it, and therefore we'll see the first Tory-free Wales since the Liberal landslide of 1906.
How have the Nationalists done?
Well, it's been mixed fortunes for them. They've held on to their four seats, which they'll be pleased about, and indeed in a couple of them they bolstered their majority there. But really they didn't break out of their strongholds. That's the north and west of Wales, where the Welsh language is very strong, the rural areas. In the rest of Wales, really, they did very much the same as they did in 1992. Perhaps not surprising when you're seeing such a huge surge towards Labour. But they will be disappointed with the overall share of the popular vote, which they've got, which is only about 10%, very marginally up on last time.
Tim, thanks. I think we can hear as well now from Denis Murray, who is in Northern Ireland. Yes, there he is at Belfast City Hall. Denis, the counting hasn't even begun yet, has it, or is it about to begin?
It's about to begin. It'll start at 9 o'clock, and there were overnight counts here at the last election, but for security reasons, really, since the troubles began, there have been very few overnight counts here. They start the count at 9 o'clock. We've just seen the counters go into the West Belfast constituency there, and we'll start getting our first results about lunchtime.
And are we looking at the realistic prospect of Sinn Féin winning two seats?
We're looking at a very realistic prospect of Sinn Féin possibly winning three seats. I think Gerry Adams is a favourite to take West Belfast back from Joe Hendron, although there were reports last night that there was very heavy tactical voting for Joe Hendron of the SDLP from unionists in the Shankill part of the West Belfast constituency. Sinn Féin might also win Mid Ulster and the new seat of West Tyrone, but that's the one that's too close to call. Nobody really knows who's going to win either of those seats, frankly, and this is small beer, I suppose, compared to the overnight results, but it's one of the most interesting elections we've had here in a very long time.
And if Sinn Féin do get any of those seats, A, are they going to take them up, and B, what are they going to expect from the new Labour government?
Well, Sinn Féin have a policy, it's actually in the party's constitution, that they don't take seats at Westminster, so if they do get any MPs elected, they will be abstentionists. I've been listening to Sinn Féin spokesman this morning saying that yes, they're welcome that there's a new Labour government. I think most of the politicians here are very glad that there's a large majority. I think a lot of people here feel that John Major had one hand tied behind his back on the peace process here because of the narrowness of the Conservative majority. This time there's going to be a very strong government, but Mo Molum, who we all expect to be the new Northern Ireland Secretary, has made it very clear that the same rules for Sinn Féin will still apply. Nobody will talk to them until there's a new IRA ceasefire.
Denis, thank you very much. Let me just tell you the time, in case you've got somewhere to go. You might be a new Labour MP, I guess, with a train to catch to London. It is just a minute or two before 20 minutes to nine. Now we can be joined on the line from the Midlands and the North West by two former Conservative MPs. They are no longer Conservative MPs, Nick Budgen and David Hunt. Good morning to you both.
Good morning.
Nick Budgen, at the end of the day, Europe, which concerned you so much, actually didn't matter, did it? Because people have not voted any more for those Conservatives who espoused Euroscepticism than for those Conservatives who didn't.
I'm not sure that's true. I really haven't looked at the figures as closely as you suggest. I thought
it didn't save you, did it, your scepticism?
Well, it didn't save me, but in fact, the result that we had in Wolverhampton South West was rather good as compared to some of the others in the neighbourhood.
Why did you lose?
Well, because I didn't get enough votes, obviously. But
yes, perhaps we could go into a more profound analysis though at this stage.
Well, I think we shall have to go into a more profound analysis, but all I can say is that the swing of 9.5 in Wolverhampton South West was not as high as in some seats.
Do you blame John Major for the loss of your seat?
Certainly not, no.
Do you think that he should go or stay?
I think he should, I'm no longer a Member of Parliament, and the electorate are Tory Members of Parliament. My diffident suggestion would be that he should remain at least until the autumn.
Mr. Hunt, what's your view on Mr. Major's future?
Oh, I very much want him to stay and remain our leader, and I agree with Stephen Dorrell. The most important thing is to reflect on this result and learn the lessons that need to be learned.
The trouble is that the people won't, will they? They will reflect on it and they will have the same sort of arguments that you were having before the election and indeed during the election campaign. Where is an end in sight?
Well, I think we can take a few lessons from what happened to the Labour Party. They haven't won a general election until now for 23 years. And I think one of the reasons was that they did divide pretty dramatically, in particular after defeat. Now, I reckon the Conservative Party is a great party because it does come together in defeat. And the way forward is unity, recrimination.
Surely the obvious way forward is actually a split. It's the opposite of unity, because there are people who disagree so profoundly about such important matters.
No, I don't agree with you at all. I think that would be the way backwards. We want to look forward to building for success at the next election.
Mr. Hunt and Mr. Budgen, thank you both very much for joining us. Now, let's have an update of what's been going on so far. It is just after 20 minutes to 9. Important that we keep on updating you, that people, of course, joining us all the time, and indeed people leaving us all the time. For those who've just joined us, Tony Blair will be the next Prime Minister as Labour celebrate its biggest victory ever. It was a landslide of historic proportions, with the latest results showing Labour have won a massive majority. The current prediction is that they will lead by 179 seats, a majority of 179. There is the Prime Minister not answering that crucial question. Will you stay as party leader? He'll tender his resignation to the Queen later this morning. He said his party had been comprehensively defeated. And look at the state of the parties. 330 seats is the winning post there. You can see Labour very comfortably over. After 629 results, Labour have 417, the Conservatives 160, the Liberal Democrats have 41. The Nationalists in Wales and Scotland have 10, and the other parties have 1. Now, I think we can join by Paul Burden, who is down there in the city. What's happening, Paul? What reaction is there so far?
Well, indeed, when we were talking earlier, we were saying there hadn't been a great deal of reaction. There has been some. Now, I think the markets are taking on board the fact that this really has been a substantial change in the political landscape. They accepted Labour were going to win very handsomely, but the cutting down of the Conservative representation in the House really has begun to get the markets thinking. And a consequence of that, we've seen some decline in the value of the pound. I think we can show you that now. It's down against the Deutsche Mark over 3 Pfennigs, 276. It was near 280 at one point overnight. It did initially go up, actually, after the first exit polls. It's also down a little bit against the dollar as well. I think we can see they're down about a couple of cents. As you can see, they're down to 60.40. I think that this is partly to do with uncertainty. It's also to do with the fact that there is a feeling that there is a need for the incoming government to perhaps manage the present exchange rate downwards. There's a very influential article by Anatole Kolevsky, the Times distinguished economics editor this morning, suggesting that this is one of the urgent tasks the Labour government should face, a gradual depreciation of sterling. Now, it is too high. He's saying if they don't do it now, okay, that may perhaps result in them facing a bit of a crisis later. So all those factors. And finally, can I tell you very, very briefly,
the equity
market, the value of shares, in fact, has not declined as much as people thought it might do this morning. Okay. Down under 17 points. Some people are saying it would be 50 points down this morning. So at least their confidence not too badly dented.
Paul, thank you. Let us go north now to Scotland, where extraordinary things have been happening, and Sally Magnusson is there to tell us about them. Sally.
Thanks, Justin. And I'm joined in the building that's set to house the new devolved Scottish Parliament by Alex Salmond, who's leader of the Scottish National Party. Alex, you would prefer this building actually to house an independent Scottish Parliament, but that option has been comprehensively rejected once again by the Scottish people. It wasn't a great night for you, was it?
Oh, don't be daft. We doubled our seats. We
doubled from 3 to 6, well, not
sure,
a lot.
Well, we increased our share of the vote against a Labour landslide. Now, we're the only party to manage to do that.
By 1%?
Well, 22% of the vote, 6 seats, 41 second places around Scotland, clearly established now as the second force in Scottish politics, with huge potential for growth. And, of course, during the campaign, as you well know, one of the surveys asked people how they'd vote in a Scottish Parliament, and the answer was 39% Labour, 38% SNP. So I think you'll see some pretty broad smiles on SNP faces this morning.
It makes a bit of a nonsense of your demand to be part of the devolution referendum when it comes along with a question about independence, because if people had wanted independence, they'd have voted for you last night, wouldn't they?
Well, Labour's tactic, of course, was to remove the constitutional question from the election debate. That's what the referendum was about. But interestingly enough, of course, as much as 82% of Labour supporters think it would be fair if independence, devolution, status quo were all on the referendum ballot paper and the Scots were allowed to make a choice on the constitutional future of our nation. I mean, I want this building to house a Scottish Parliament, but I want it to house a sovereign Scottish Parliament, not an English parish council.
In what must seem with hindsight a rather unwise bet, you bet that the SNP would get between 7 and 40 seats. So by your own criteria, you have failed. Is it time to let somebody take over the leadership of the Scottish National
Party? Well, there's still one seat to declare yet, of course. Now, I don't know if you've got any inside information.
I think the thought is the Liberal Democrats will get it.
Well, perhaps. We'll see. But the bet, of course, was with money supplied by William Hills, and the proceeds, win or lose, were going to the Big Issue magazine. Now, it was a good cause. It was an each-way bet. And I still think the SNP are smiling today.
So you're not about to offer your job to somebody else?
No, I think given the strength of the SNP performance and the reaction of SNP supporters, which is one of delight to Lent and Bread for Scotland, I think I might be around for some time to come. I'm the youngest of the party leaders.
Alex Salmond, thank you very much indeed. Back to you, Justin.
Sally, thanks. Neil Kinnock is still here in the studio with us. Neil Kinnock, we were talking briefly earlier about your feelings for John Major, about what you've been saying to Tony Blair. This day for you is a day that many, many times you must have hoped for, but really many, many times you must have thought would never come. When it did come, when you realised it was happening and it was for real, what went through your mind?
Absolutely unreserved joy. I've been certain of victory. I've been amongst those anticipating substantial majority. And even I was taken by surprise, as I think everyone else was, by this gigantic majority, which only increased the delight that I feel at the way in which Tony Blair and his colleagues in the leadership of the Labour Party won this election.
Can you bring yourself to be pleased now that you didn't win
I wouldn't be pleased. I wouldn't be pleased about that.
But we wouldn't be here if you had, would it? It'd be a very different setup. The party would not have had the time to continue with the changes that it did continue.
Well, I've said before to you that there's an interesting doctoral thesis in that, and that's another one. But I wanted to win last time. The party wanted to win on the last occasion. We would have made significant difference and change, and a lot of what's occurred in the last 5 years would not have occurred to the benefit of the British people. But at the same time, the foundation was laid. It was built upon brilliantly, and the result is historic.
Okay, Neil Kinnock. Thank you. There is one thing that we can't avoid, even on a day of such momentous news, and that is the weather, and here is John Ketley.
Thank you, Justin. Well, the sunshine is the majority shareholder today. Plenty of blue skies across the country. There is some cloud across the far north of Scotland. That will edge a little bit further south as time goes by. But we should see some sunshine moving down into Shetland this morning, and then we'll find that thicker cloud with some drizzle moving a little bit further south during the afternoon. Elsewhere, though, it's blue skies virtually all the way. Strong sunshine, 35 minutes, and you will begin to burn today, with temperatures reaching 25 degrees over central and southern parts of England, but noticeably colder today up across the Murray Firth, for example, near a 15 there compared with the 21 or so yesterday. Well, tonight, some drizzle moving a little bit further south. Temperatures tonight down to about 7 to 9 degrees, but the first signs of the breakdown for the holiday weekend. See some showery bursts of rain moving up towards the Isles of Scilly by the morning, and some showers breaking out across other parts of the West Country into the south of Wales and Southern Ireland during Saturday afternoon. Elsewhere across southern Britain, a pretty warm day once again on Saturday, more sunshine to come, but the colder weather digging in from the north, some wintry showers perhaps developing, across northeastern Scotland during Saturday, and it really does begin to go downhill pretty rapidly for Sunday and then Monday. Some quite nasty conditions in some areas. Having said that, of course, some very welcome rain to come as well. So quite heavy bursts of rain across these central and northern parts of Britain, but certainly a big change after today's glorious sunshine once again. Back to Justin.
John, thank you very much. Let us leave you now in the last few minutes with some of the images that have made this night the extraordinary night that it has been. Those are pictures, live pictures of 10 Downing Street, with the policeman at the ready there, ready for the new occupant and ready to say goodbye to the old one. John Major, when he knew he was defeated, said, "We are a great historic party, the Conservative Party. We have had great victories in our time. We have had great defeats. Tonight we have been comprehensively defeated," he said. "We have listened to the voice of the electorate. We will consider what has been told to us. We must reflect upon it." And Tony Blair said, "We are building a party of which we are proud. The country is crying out for the new Labour Party." Goodbye.
Good morning from the southeast, a region which more than most has gone through a political transformation overnight. Counties like Kent and Hertfordshire have their first Labour MPs in nearly 20 years. A map which was awash with blue has been repainted red with dashes of Liberal Democrat gold. Labour gained 21 seats outside the capital, 24 within it. And some of the biggest guns in the Tory party were forced into retreat. Defence Secretary Michael Portillo, Dame Angela Rumbold, the party vice chairman, London Transport Minister John Bowis and former Cabinet Minister Jonathan Aitken, all of their seats fell to Labour. For the Conservatives, it was a night when the unthinkable quickly gave way to the incredible. A night for brave faces, the odd wry smile, and an escape of raw grief as the party lost three quarters of their MPs in London and dozens more beyond. First to succumb to the charms of New Labour, Basildon in Essex.
Tonight's spectacular result makes it clear that 18 years of Tory government has now ended.
1,500 votes is a derisory total.
Sir James Goldsmith revelling in the defeat of David Mellor in Putney. Votes for the referendum party helped hand the seat to Labour. Mr Mellor repaid Sir James in kind.
I'm afraid that Putney said, "Up your hacienda, Jimmy."
The message from the voters to Mr Mellor and other London Conservatives seemed to be much the same. The combined effect of opposition wins, leaving the capital with just 10 Tory MPs. Most were tight-lipped in defeat, but the outgoing MP for Welwyn Hatfield in Hertfordshire was his usual blunt self.
"I think the government, broken promises, VAT on fuel, ERM fiasco, couldn't get their act together on Europe."
Up the road, Tory gloom deepened as Labour leapt from third place to first in St Albans, a seat they haven't held since 1951, evidence that the split in anti-Tory votes which saved some Conservatives at the last election no longer applies. Rebellion over the closure of Edgware Hospital failed to take the North London MPs Hugh Dykes and Sir John Gorst off the Tory critical list. Labour took both seats.
John Major is likely to be especially disappointed to have lost the two constituencies in Luton, where he launched the Conservatives' election campaign 5 weeks ago. As Mr Major put away his soapbox, others, like the new MP for Stevenage, Barbara Follett, were struggling to come to terms with victory and to maintain their reputation as champagne socialists.
Well, of course, the biggest shock in London was the loss of Michael Portillo's Enfield seat. It shattered his prospects of standing in any forthcoming Conservative leadership contest.
Even election experts believe the Defence Secretary's seat was unassailable, but the odds were soon stacking up against him.
Twig, Stephen, Labour Party, 20,507.
To their surprise and joy, Labour took Enfield Southgate with a massive 17% swing.
A truly terrible night for the Conservatives. I would have wished to have been part of rebuilding it inside the House of Commons. I can't now do that, but I would like to do whatever I can from the wings.
In a clean sweep up the Lee Valley, Labour also took Edmonton and Enfield North.
Apart from ending Michael Portillo's leadership ambitions, the results here push Conservative representation in North East London to the outer fringes. Like other areas of the South East that suffered high unemployment under the Tories, voters here turned Labour in greater numbers than virtually anywhere else. Ryan Milligan, Newsroom South East, North East London.
Well, the Liberal Democrats have good reason to celebrate. After several years of local government success, they won six seats and fulfilled their long-cherished ambition of taking control of Oxford West and Abingdon.
And I do hereby declare that Evan Harris has been duly elected as the Member of Parliament for the Oxford West and Abingdon. Yeah!
It was the result the Liberal Democrats have long been waiting for, a seat that's been Conservative for 18 years. Dr. Evan Harris won with a 7,000 majority, reducing the Tory vote at the last election by 8,000.
I'm absolutely delighted for myself personally, because I've been campaigning for 10 years on these sort of things, but also for the party, because we've made a gain here.
Disappointment was clear on the face of the man who'd hoped to take over from the former Education Minister John Paton, who stepped down.
Three cheers for Evan Harris!
For the victors, the celebrations have gone on throughout the morning. Jackie Bartley, Newsroom South East, Oxford.
In Essex, one of the most flamboyant Conservative characters, Gerry Hayes, was heavily defeated in Harlow. Labour now has a majority of there of more than 10,000, but Mr Hayes stayed positive.
In facing defeat after 14 years as a Conservative MP, Gerry Hayes was remarkably upbeat. During the campaign, he's been punched, attacked by a dog, and even been the target of a flower missile. But he didn't feel his recent bad fortunes, including allegations about his private life, had any bearing on the result.
No, I don't think that's made a heck of a difference at all. People are far more sensible than that.
So Gerry, what are you going to be doing next?
Well, I don't know. Not your job. It's not enough money. I'm open to offers, though.
Not one to avoid the limelight, it's probably not the last we'll see of Gerry Hayes. Sarah Harris, Newsroom South East, Harlow.
Well, attention turns now from defeated Conservatives to what Labour will mean for the South East, and our political editor Don Brin is with me now. Don, are Labour surprised at some of the places that they now find themselves with MPs?
Yes, I think they were. We had the Mr Blair warning about landslides, saying this country didn't have landslides. Actually, if you look at the record, we do have rather a lot, but I think that was a way of getting the voters out. But what it does mean is that his ambition for serving at least two terms is much, much easier. He's got a huge cushion come the next election. The Tories will need him to be spectacularly bad in governing the country to have really much chance of winning the next election.
But is there a danger that expectations have now been raised beyond his ability to meet them?
Well, that may well happen. People may make comparisons with 1945, a government that transformed the country, and say, why doesn't Mr Blair's government do it? But I suppose you'd have to say this morning, if you're looking to see who had the problems, you'd probably guess the Tories had rather more problems than Mr Blair.
Don Brin, thank you very much. Well, as news spread of Labour's landslide victory, supporters gathered outside London's Royal Festival Hall for an impromptu celebration.
Some brought the family, some the extended family, as Labour followers threw a spontaneous party on London's South Bank.
The fact that the Tories have gone is the most wonderful thing that could have happened in my life. Absolutely marvellous.
Oh, just like dancing around London and drinking and
much. I'm here to support and...
What do you hope for a new Labour government?
I hope for choice in education and a future in Europe.
And while supporters hoped it was the dawn of a new age under new Labour, for many, there'll be a hangover to sleep off first. Anthony Dorr, Newsroom South East in central London.
Looks like the celebrations will be going on for some time yet. That's all from us for now, but we'll have a next summary at just after midday here on BBC One, plus a full analysis of the regional results here in the South East and reaction from the main party players in our region. That's at 12:30. You can join Mike Embley then and me at midday. But for now, from all of us in the South East, a very good morning to you.
This Saturday on the National Lottery Live, news of one of the largest ever heritage awards for Britain's canals, a record £25 million, plus special guests ABC with their new single and Caprice joining Bob Monkhouse for his last show and Mystic Meg, tomorrow at the earlier time, 7:45, BBC One.
This is BBC One.